I thought I did it, but apparently I haven't really done it. And I guess according
when
to the interview,
when are you going to do it?
I guess I'm going to do it right after this is over. Try to.
We hope we can pray together when it's a new start. Okay.
Two, Air Force records revealed that a plane and a crew had completely disappeared on their first combat mission. The aircraft was found an incredible 1,000 miles past its target. Investigators found that the crew had bailed out of the plane just before it crashed in the 140-degree Libyan desert. Most of the crew's bodies were discovered 78 miles from where they bailed out. One of the men had walked an incredible 140 miles before he died. What baffled military experts for years was how any plane could end up 1,000 miles past its target. This is what happened. A strong tailwind had caused them to arrive at their destination faster than what they'd estimated. The instruments told them they'd arrived, but they made the fatal mistake of not believing their instruments, and instead they trusted their own natural senses.
There is a way which seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death.
So don't make the same even more fatal mistake when it comes to your eternal salvation. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him and He'll direct your path.
In light of these thoughts, it's interesting to notice that at the age of 34, a young Albert Einstein proudly boasted of something that seemed right to him.
I have firmly resolved to bite the dust when my time comes, with the minimum of medical assistance. And up to then, I will sin to my wicked heart's content.
As Albert Einstein aged, he became far more philosophical.
To one bent on age, death will come as a release. I feel this quite strongly now that I've grown old myself and have come to regard death like an old debt, at long last to be discharged. Still, instinctively, one does everything possible to postpone the final settlement. Such is the game that nature plays with us.
It seems that Albert Einstein spoke biblical truth unawares. However, it isn't nature that seeks a final settlement, it's the law of God. Like a criminal who's transgressed civil law, Einstein, like the rest of humanity, was in debt to eternal justice because he had transgressed God's law. This great debt that he spoke of couldn't be satisfied with mere silver and gold. It's a debt that demands capital punishment. It calls for the death penalty for guilty transgressors, an eternal damnation in hell. Its terrible decree demands the soul that sins, it shall die. But it's a demand that was fully satisfied by the one who cried from Calvary's cross, "It is finished." It was paid in full by the precious blood of Jesus.
For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God.
Most of us think that we're rather intelligent, and the more knowledge we get, the more puffed up we become with pride. If you don't believe it, try talking to the average university student about the things of God. They're more than often condescending towards the gospel. They think they're too intelligent to believe it. Their attitude brings up a very important point.
A man once looked into a store window and he saw a sight that he could hardly believe. There was a cat sitting in the window, and it was a mangy cat. It was a flea-bitten, rat-ridden, ugly cat. His ear was chewed off, his tail was chewed off, half his fur was missing. I mean, this was an ugly cat. And then his eyes widened because next to the cat there was a sign, and it said, "Cat for sale, $50. He thought, what? Somebody wants 50 bucks for a flea-bitten, rat-ridden, ugly cat? He couldn't believe it. And then he saw something that made his eyes widen even further. The cat was drinking milk from a saucer that he recognized as a Ming Dynasty saucer, worth thousands of dollars. So he immediately grabbed his wallet, ran into the store, and said, "Hey, mister, I'll take that cat. Thanks a lot. And here's your 50 bucks." And then he picked up the cat, and he said, "By the way, I'll just take that old saucer to keep the cat company." And the guy said, "You leave that saucer right there. I've sold 70 cats with that saucer this week."
That man was snared or trapped by his own craftiness. And the Bible says that God has ensnared the wicked by their own craftiness. What does that mean? Let me explain. Many years ago, I ran a kids' club. At its conclusion, I would take a big bag of candy and give them a piece of candy each. One day, I told the kids to line up, and as I looked at that line, I saw that the little brat bullies had pushed their way to the front. At the back of the line were the meek, quiet, sickly ones. I remember thinking, that's a line of greed if ever I saw one. Then I had an idea. I said, kids, stay where you are. Everybody turn about face. I said, if you move and get out of line, you're not getting any candy. Every kid turned about face, and I had great delight in taking that big bag of candy to the other end of the line first and giving it to the meek, sickly, quiet kids, much to the disgust of the greedy fat brats at the back. That's how God has trapped the wicked in his own craftiness. God has turned the line around. In this world where the rich get richer and the poor get stomped on, God has done something incredible. The Bible says God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. You just ask a proud person if they'll admit that they're a sinner, therefore are deserving of hell, and are willing to repent and follow Jesus Christ no matter what the cost, and you'll usually hear, "What are you kidding me? I don't believe that silly message." Behold, the wisdom of God. The Bible says that God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. He's chosen the not many wise, the not many mighty, the not many noble. You find that people who are proud of their intellectual abilities, their social standing, their great accomplishments will really stoop to believe the gospel. Through their own pride, they exclude themselves from understanding the truth. God designed it this way and even said that we must come to him as what? As a little child.
So if you want to enter heaven, be wise. Make sure you humble yourself as a little child and don't trust in your own understanding. Remember, human nature is prone to error. The man who put the eraser on the tip of the pencil knew what he was doing. What we need to do is turn back to God's instruction book, the Bible, the ultimate source of reliability and wisdom.
We hope this program has been both entertaining and helpful to you in understanding the great truth that God has chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. Thanks for joining us.